stare at it for a second, like it's going to come back to you.
Well, you know, I still run the I still run calls with guys sometimes half my age, and I'm working nights this particular month. And, you know, running up and down stairs with a 40-pound first impact and a 18-pound life pack 15. And now the Lucas, if you, it comes out as a cardiac arrest, you know, the CPR, the thumper, as we call it, that's another 12 to 15 pounds. And you're sharing that load, of course, with your partner, but it takes a toll on you. And I'm still glad I could do it, but it hurts. Now it's starting to hurt physically.
In the time that you've been doing it, EMS and fire, and technology's going through a lot of changes, do you think we're dramatically different, dramatically better because of technology, or are we just different? Like we talked about, tourniquets are back, you know? And I feel like sometimes these things just have this cycle that they go through.
Yeah. It's sort of like the American Heart Association.
Yes.
Every 5 years, they change the protocol.
Yeah.
Sometimes it goes forward, sometimes it goes back. But, you know, I think the changes have been for the good. We've gotten rid of drugs we have not found to be effective. And we've added some techniques that we do find effective. Our ROSC, let's say, you know, return of spontaneous circulation, has increased threefold because of just the Lucas and high-performance CPR. The CPR, when I say Lucas, for those who are not familiar with it, it's the automated CPR machine, which is invaluable. You know, as long as everything's placed right, it's working right, it's going to do CPR 10 times better than any human being's going to do it.
And that's because we just have trouble generating enough force. The heart generates a lot of force, and we can't simulate that. And this machine can generate a lot more concentrated force, doesn't tire. Because CPR is exhausting.
It is. And you know, as you're becoming more exhausted or somebody else steps in, their level of performance is maybe not up to snuff. As this machine's going to give you the same depth of compressions and rate every time.
Well, and I think one of the good things potentially about a machine is that sometimes you'll be doing CPR and you'll just have a mindset that the person isn't going to make it. You know, you're not going to be able to carry this through. And the machine doesn't have that judgment. It's just a machine.
That could be. You know, I think we get so focused on the job that none of us ever get that, you know, a shoulder slumped. Well, why are we even bothering? Let's face it, most of our cardiac arrests are on the geriatric community. So, you know, you're going, why did these folks even call us? Why don't you let Granny just go peacefully in bed? Do you know what's coming?
Right.
You know, they're going to be dragged out of this warm bed and possible rib fractures from CPR and intubation. And
that's something people don't realize. It's like when you're doing CPR on somebody who's elderly, you're almost hurting them to do it because they're frail, your rib fractures, yeah, cracking ribs, you know, all kinds of things.
But it's not my place to try to understand why –
right.
People can't let their loved ones go, even though it sometimes would seem like the better thing to do.
Yeah.
And dialing 911 for 85, 95-year-old person whose rest can just pass away in their sleep, let's say.
And we just, you know, no matter what, we show up and do our best.
Oh, yeah.
Whoever they are, what age, mm-hmm. What's the hardest part of the job?
Well, the thing that always gets me is, and I think all EMS responders would probably agree, are the pediatric cases and the ones that do not have a positive outcome. And any kind of youthful loss of life, you know, vehicle accidents with people under the age of 25, I've been on a number of them, and you have a fatality. You work the job, you work it hard, and it. I'll say this, every time it gets me when I get home and I put my head on the pillow and my shift is over, my tour is done. And when my head hits that pillow and my eyes close, that's when it all comes back to me. And that's the most stressful thing that I find in this industry.
What's frustrating is like – babies, infants, like you said, pediatrics, mm-hmm. that I can't deal with that at all. Not that any of it is good, but some of it's more understandable or acceptable. And there's something about the innocence factor. But
yeah, so as I get older, you know, being now the old man in the squad, you want folks to be able to have all the experiences you were able to have, and everyone else should be able to have. And when it's taken from them at such a young age, it's it hits me hard. Hits me in the gut.
One of the things that people don't factor in, they don't teach you when you take the training or whatever, is that sensitivity to people that are younger than you. As you get older, there's more and more people younger than you and less older than you, mm-hmm. you know. So you see a lot of things that are, you know, I can get saddened now by people in their 20s, you know.
Yeah.
When you started, your 20s was like, you know, it didn't matter. I was only a few years younger than you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, now it's, you know, you look at it and you think, if I could go back and be that age again, you know, especially when people, you know, do things to themselves, that just – annoys me to no end when they waste it and they haven't done anything, they haven't had a chance, or they get cheated. What abilities do you think make you good at EMS and fire?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think for me to speak about my fire days are archaic. I haven't had many fire experiences. But, you know, if I could just drift back to when I was essential on a fire type job, I would say it was the ability just to lead my crew in and make sure my crew came back out. And, you know, if we could put water on that fire, then we were doing a good thing. And that was the plus. In EMS, my biggest contribution to the industry is, you know, I like to be able to hold a person's hand. I like to be able to talk to my patient. There's a lot of mechanical and science we do, but to be actually able to smile to somebody who's ill or, you know, losing their life, and smile with warmth, to hold their hand, to be able to look in their eyes and try to give them comfort and let them know that somebody's with them that really cares, is what I would like to leave as my greatest accomplishment in the EMS industry. Not that I was the best at reading the 12 lead EKGs and algorithms and all the chemistry involved, but that I could bring the human side of it forward.
That's something they still don't teach as much as they should, because you can see sometimes your voice, your tone, your words coming through on the monitor in their vitals. You know?
Oh yeah. You can talk people out almost out of a state of shock. If, as long as they're, you know, they're freaking out and they're bleeding or they're having the big MI, there's a lot to be said for putting some water on a situation and calming them down a bit. It's sure to be said, but I would like that to be my legacy. If I could, you know, look back on years to come when I'm in that old age home now and they come to get me, which they will be doing, I'll go, I remember when. You ought to warm up, young fella.
Yeah. What's that you're putting on me?
You know, I'm not just a bag of potatoes here.
Have you seen changes in the EMS industry and the patients? I mean, I'm sure you're doing it enough as a regular job where you're seeing the impact of drugs and stuff like that. It's bleeding over in every community.
Well, the opiate crisis is...
What percentage would you say that impacts calls?
Well, Cheltenham has not been hit very hard with that, as I compare to other communities where I, you know, fellow, my co-workers who work other squads, as most EMS providers do, and I hear some real nightmares, you know, 40, 50, 60 opiate overdose calls a month. We're not anything close to that so far. But it is sad, isn't it? Isn't it, Mark, that young folks, some brilliant young folks, somehow got directed down this bad avenue, and it's killing them.
It's it's worse because they've got so many options than they used to be. It used to be people would buy heroin or they'd smoke marijuana or whatever they do. Now there's so many variants, and there's kits where people can make their custom blends, and it's tougher to counteract that. And lots of times you have people that overdose, and the people that are with them, if they do tell you anything, can't even tell you what they took, really, you know, what the mix was.
Well, you know, I've been on all kinds of calls, as all us EMS providers have been on, where there is a psych component involved. There might have been an underlying psych history there, and then some strange brew of chemicals has only made it 1,000 times worse. And, you know, we've had some real excitement out there on the streets with that. But they're far and few between, you know.
Do you see seasonality in the job?
And how's that?
As far as calls, do you see, like, I remember, you know, we'd see if we had it rain for 3 days in a row, we might see domestics go up a little bit. You know,
what you're saying. Well, you know, we get it when the snow falls, you get the fingers or something, some kind of a hand injury from the snowblower. I just remember one that was so sad. I had a 20-year-old male who tried to remove a stick from a big old 3-stage snowblower. And he did the most stupid thing you could do, which is stick your hand in there and try to remove it. It took off all of his fingers right down to the, you know, to the first knuckle. And I knew they weren't going to be salvageable because while the other medic was working with him, I went out and tried to recover them, and they were just ligaments. It looked like linguine in the snow. And I just looked at his face, and 20 years old, he was right-hand dominant. And I go, this has just changed your life, and you don't even realize it yet. I didn't say that, of course.
Right.
But his life has just been altered in a blink of an eye.
It's so, not that you want something to happen to anybody at any age, but you see people that have things now, and I don't know if we're diagnosing everything quicker or whatever, but they have it younger. And you think about, I was dealing with somebody that had diabetes and needed the whole implant and everything, and he's in his 20s. He could live to be 80, you know, and have that all his life. Yeah. You know, I'm used to stuff because people wouldn't go in our generation, didn't like to even go to the doctor, you know. I mean, a running joke was the way you went to the doctor was in an ambulance, you know. You wouldn't go until you put it off so long, and then you'd hit 55, and then they tell you you've got something, you know, deal with it from then on out.
You know, that's a good point. You know, there's such a good health care. And in our community, Cheltenham Township, for the most part, the residents of that township, you know, see their general practitioners, or they're being, you know, their medical experience is a good one because they're having their issues taken care of. But when they dial 911, conversely for us, they're really sick. You know, we're not just getting, well, you know, we get a fair amount of the stupid calls. But when folks are, particularly on night shift, when they're dialing 911 at 3 a.m, there's a real issue going on. And they're smarter, too, because they all have Dr. Google, and they know everything there is to know about medicine, or they think they do. So they're already a little ahead of the game by the time you get there.
The Dr. Google, it's amazing that I see sometimes people are right, but they don't know when they're wrong, and they think they're always right. But it's you can never beat Dr. Google, and because of that, sometimes I felt like the job was just to get them to a real doctor, and so that they could just work it out amongst them and not be part of the debate. We're going to do a little after show. Thank you for coming. See that one fast?
Yeah, that was quick.
Do a little bit of after show with Ken Beerger.